Tonight, it's everything you've ever wanted to know about boomerangs and more when we visit the Vermonter who's turned the making of Australia's famous throwing stick into a science. Eric Darnell shows us how to make the great American boomerang, then takes it down under for a test against the world's best. And storyteller Tim Jennings returns with yet another of his one-man epic tales of heroes, villains, magic, and witchcraft.
Welcome to Crossroads. I'm Enzo Di Maio. The recreational novelty market is famous for its many overnight success stories. The hula hoop and frisbee are typical of the phenomenon. Simple new designs coupled with high-powered marketing resulting in record-breaking sales. And then there are the also-rans, products that for one reason or another just never catch on. Take the boomerang, thousands of years in development and still not many takers. Why? Well, for one thing, few commercial boomerangs have ever been designed correctly. And for another, most manufacturers fail to provide proper instruction. We found a boomerang entrepreneur right here in Vermont who's dedicated himself to changing all of that, and in the process discovered a great new sport that's 10,000 years old.
I've always been interested in flight. It's been a fascination since I was very young. I love to watch the birds fly, and I've always liked airplanes. I had my first airplane ride when I was 3, and I've made lots and lots of gliders. And when I was about 12, I got discouraged because I started getting really good at making gliders, and I started losing a lot of them. And I started looking around for wings that would come back, and the obvious wings that return are a boomerang.
Eric Darnell is the undisputed technical master of the modern-day version of the sport of boomeranging. For this Vermont entrepreneur, the oddly shaped throwing stick from down under has transcended boyhood curiosity and become a way of life.
I started trying to make some boomerangs and then figured out, well, it's just a couple of wings put together. And it took me almost a year to get any to work well. But I've been fascinated with flight and with boomerangs ever since, and there's never-ending challenge of coming up with new stuff and experimenting, and that's what keeps me going in it.
The boomerang's 10,000-year history is steeped in the ancient traditions of the Australian Aborigines, probably originating as a hunting device, which when hurled into a flock of wildfowl could bring down several birds at a throw. Early explorers returned with accounts of Aboriginal skirmishes involving bent wooden swords, but the likeliest ancestor of the modern boomerang was probably an all-purpose wooden implement used for digging, cleaving, napping flint, and even making music, and based on the Aboriginal throwing stick.
This is an authentic Aboriginal throwing stick. And there's a common misconception that throwing sticks and boomerangs are the same thing. And it turns out that they've had both types of throwing devices from very, very early antiquity. This is very heavy. It's made out of mulga wood, which is a dense growing tree near the desert. It has sharp tips and very sharp edges. And it's really designed for hunting and as a weapon. It's thrown sideways, unlike a boomerang, and it's really designed to just keep flying as accurately as it's thrown. And I've seen a film of an Aborigine hitting something 220 meters away, which is a long, long ways away. This, on the other hand, is a returning boomerang, and this is designed to come back. It has airfoils like wings. It's very light, weighs about a third of a pound. And it's thrown, as a boomerang is, almost vertically, so that it goes around, comes around, and comes back, and is catchable. For years, I was just hand-making my own boomerangs for my own use. And then in the mid-70s, I started going to tournaments down in Washington, D.C., and there were a lot of throwers there that had some boomerangs that were so-called commercial, and they seemed to like mine better, so it sort of forced me to start making boomerangs for other people.
Darnell's hand-built ridgetop home on the Sharon South Stratford town line is the unlikely headquarters of a successful specialty manufacturing enterprise ever so appropriately called Turning Point.
In 1985, I co-authored a book on boomerangs that sold 100,000 worldwide, and I made a mold before making the boomerang for that book, because I wasn't going to make 100,000 boomerangs by hand. And from that molded boomerang, I now have quite a few variety of alterations that I do to it that makes it useful for different events and different types of throwing. So I've sort of come full circle, because now I'm making quite a few boomerangs for myself again, and designing new ones is still the real intriguing thing for me, and that I do right here. I'm always amazed at how you can keep coming up with new designs that are slight variations, but really exciting.
One can only conjecture on how the earliest boomerangs were crafted. This is how the primitive throwing implement is made 100 centuries later.
The rough sander is a belt sander with a very coarse grit, and it takes a lot of material off in a hurry. I don't have to look at the side where the material is being taken off to know what's going on, because I've made so many boomerangs. But I can really bear down and just take material off in a hurry, and it's very satisfying how quickly you can make a rough shape of the airfoils on the boomerang. The rough sander accomplishes most of the bulk of the sanding of the boomerang to make the airfoil. The leading edge here I try to keep steep, and then the trailing edge I keep shallow, and then it comes around and translates into the leading edge in the next wing. And that means this boomerang is rotating in this direction, which makes it a right-handed boomerang. So now I can go and work on the fine sander and turn it into a nice smooth shape between the two. The pneumatic sander is a wonderful device for finishing boomerangs. It uses the air cushion so you can bear down and get a round contour very easily to finish up the edges, so you don't end up with any rough or sharp edges, but it's all nice and round and smooth and feels good to the hand. I stamp all my boomerangs because I consider them calling cards going around the world, and when people are interested in boomerangs and they see one, it gives them the address of where to write and who to write to. When I'm painting the boomerangs, I'm conscious of making them safe and fun and easy to see in the air, so I use very bright colors. It's just the standard enamel, and then I put a clear coat on top of acrylic to protect it from the elements.
The Darnell House is one of the best-stocked boomerang repositories in the world. Gathered over his 30 years in the sport, Eric's collection includes many one-of-a-kind creations that reflect the endless design possibilities.
Here's the Tomahawk boomerang, and it flies beautifully. It finds its own center of rotation, and it's a lot of fun to throw and catch. Here's one made out of aluminum. This one's designed for the distance competition, and it goes out about 120 meters and then comes back, which is pretty impressive.